All right. Today I have as a guest with me Senator Roger Chamberlain, and I want to thank you for coming today and out of your busy schedule. Of course, you got a busy weekend this weekend, don't you, with parades and...
Just came from, thank you, Tim. Came from Market Fest, spent an hour over there. Tomorrow we have the parade, first parade of the season. It's a great parade, White Bear Lake Manitou Day Parade. Great parade, a lot of fun. I expect the same this year. We'll have a lot of volunteers out there.
Good, good. Now, where is your area? What area are you representing then?
For parameters, from White Bear Lake, White Bear Township, all the way over to the edge of Blaine, Lionel Lake, Circle Pines, Lexington, North Oaks, and of course most of Lionel Lakes, Shoreview, most of Shoreview. So, from the east, White Bear Township, White Bear Lake, to the west. All the way to 35 in the west.
Okay. All right. So, why'd you run? Why'd you decide to get in this business? And I know it's been an exciting year for you, but
one day I was sitting next to Senator Gimsey on the Senate floor, and I leaned over to him and remind me why I did this again. But I ran because. I went to my first caucus in 2008, that presidential season, and I was fired up like a lot of people were. And I stood up, and then your precinct chair, and then in a month, I was asked to be on the BPLU by a local activist, Kelly Gunderson. So then I got into the BPLU, became an activist, worked with grassroots, and did that for a couple years. Yeah, I had no idea I'd be doing this. I had no idea I'd be running. So three different people asked me to consider doing this back in early January. I thought about it, prayed about it, heard some things on the radio, talked to my wife. One of the things I heard on the radio was we need people to run for office who aren't afraid, who are average, normal people.
Right.
They have a wife, a dog, a family. They do their own work in the yard. They fix their cars. They're not afraid to say, no, I don't know. And go get the answers, you know, mm-hmm. Average people from the community, citizen legislators. So for those reasons, a lot of people I respected, a lot of thought, a lot of prayer, a lot of consideration, and I was blessed to be able to do it, and had a lot of help along the way. So that's why I did it. I'm passionate about what I believe, and the bottom line is that I ran because I believe the state's in serious, serious trouble, and we needed a different direction, and we can do it. We can fix this and get it off the path we're on. If we keep going where we're going, we're going to fail. So that's what's motivated me to do it.
All right. What's some of your background, work, education?
I'll start from the last.
Okay.
I was, since 2007, been working with Ameriprise Financial. I do corporate tax, business tax for them, mm-hmm. In-house tax compliance, mostly state, do some federal stuff. Before that, I worked with Booker Restaurants, doing the same thing, federal, state taxation, all types of taxation. The late 90s, I went back to school, got an accounting degree, finished a four-year degree at Metro State in accounting, and prior to that, I had a bunch of different jobs. I was security. I worked security. I punched a clock 24/7, you know, 7 days a week. I bounced in a couple of different bars. I drove cab. I was in the Minnesota Army National Guard. Was a medic in the late 90s. I did that for 3.5 years. And then when I got out of high school, I joined the Navy. Did that for 4 years. So I think people like yourself and people like me and the colleagues that got elected with me have the same sort of backgrounds, a variety of backgrounds, accounting, legal, teaching, business owners, families, you know, a variety of backgrounds from all over the state, men, women, young, old, and that's, it's a great mix, it's a great mix.
Well, you need to have that mix. One thing I noticed in the legislature, and this is your first term.
Mm-hmm. Yes, sir.
How's the learning curve? There's a lot to learn down there, isn't there?
You came down a couple of times. It was good to see you down there and talk to you as well as the constituent. Yes, learning curve is steep. There's a lot to read, a lot to learn. I had at work today, they wanted me to give a little, I just got back to work on June 6th, and they wanted to get a little overview and insight to what I do. So it took about 20, 30 minutes to tell them, explain some things to them. It was a good conversation. They enjoyed it. They liked hearing some of the insights in the background. But I start off by saying that the first thing you realize is you don't know that much. That there's a lot to learn, and the learning continues. Yeah. And as you well know, it's a lot of reading, a lot of studying, a lot of reading bills, and it's a lot of hours. But you're able to keep up, and you got great staff and great people who are dedicated to the cause as well, and they keep you going.
Procedural issues are also a huge learning curve, just how it works down there and the internal politics of who's where, who has what opinion.
Right.
And it a lot of times it does cross party lines, and there's issues there that mm-hmm. you can't figure out where are things setting as far as majority opinions.
It's an interesting question. One of the things that was asked of me today as well was, politically, you know, I tell people most things down there are bipartisan. Mm-hmm. You know, contrary to popular belief in what they hear and what people think, most things are bipartisan. We bump heads on some of the higher level ideological issues. But procedurally, very interesting. The politics, for instance, there's rural versus metro.
Uh-huh, right.
And that cuts across political affiliations, you know, party lines. You know, especially when you get to parks and transportation. So that was an interesting discussion and debate to have in the legislature. As far as committees and all that stuff, you know, you work together on a lot of those things. You like I said, being bipartisan, you need sometimes you need the folks on the other side of the aisle. You need their help. And they need your help, mm-hmm. and you work together. Most of the time, you're civil. You may disagree.
Most of the time?
Yeah. Yeah, you're civil until they get on camera. But most of the time, it's civil. We eat lunch together in the back room, and we're polite, and we have to work together. You can't just, it's easy to go by the rules all the time. The rules will cover a lot of stuff and shut down the other side, but you remember, you shut down the other side, they can shut you down as well.
Right.
And there's opposing views on that. Some people believe you got to be hardball. Some people say, you know, you're gonna need these people later. And if you do something to them now, they're not going to be there for you later. And that's true.
Yeah.
True. But you learn a lot. Yeah, yeah.
There's a balancing act, and you really don't know. First year, I would think it'd be hard to balance and figure that out.
It was. I did a lot of listening and watching and learning. I had to listen and watch and learn quite a bit. Some of the people that ran and got elected, they had city council positions or former county commissioners or something. Some had not, but I had to listen and watch and learn quite a bit as far as the political stuff and how some of that works. That what you referred to, you know. Who do you talk to, when you talk to them, and some of the attitudes and personalities. Because
yeah.
you have to know that if you want to get stuff done.
You do. You really mm-hmm. do. Now, we're going to talk about the budget here and get into that, but we've got a phone call, so we're going to take the phone call first. So, caller, do you have a comment or a question?
I just wanted to call up and thank you for being on Tim's show, because my mind is a straight talker. And a lot of the representatives are afraid of Tim, like I'm thinking of Uyghur, Lilly, and that whole gang out here on the east side. Hey, you know, one thing that really troubles me out there, down there in the state legislature, is those guys are down there for 5 months, you know, chit-chatting, back-slapping, you know, eating in the back room, talking to lobbyists. They are, you know, if we're lucky, they give us 1 hour of a joint citizens meeting or citizens listening session per session. And after 5 months, they don't get anything done. So now, instead of having meetings in the public, in the open, and so people can bring their cameras in there behind closed doors, the power brokers are back there cutting the issues that really people care about, you know, with nobody in those rooms except, you know, the very powerful. And I hope that ends. I heard a story on NPR, and in a back slapped kind of way they complimented you. They had one representative down there was complaining that, I don't know how much you guys get paid, $35,000 or $40,000 or whatever. You were one of the few people who wasn't complaining that that wasn't enough and that you could get by without getting $35 meals for lunch and for dinner. And so, you know, I compliment you on that. The thing, there's two other questions I have here. First of all,
okay, get them out. Hurry up.
How does health insurance work for the members and their families? Do you guys get that? And the other thing is that Tony Bennett over there at the Ramsey County, have you ran into him? I mean, he's in the paper every day saying that he's down there twisting arms because, you know, we need a Viking stadium courtesy of taxpayers. Has he been down there to see you and give you his bunch of baloney? Thanks for coming on Tim's show. Thank you.
All right.
Well, thank you very much. Tim, I forget the first time I met Tim, but he came down to the office a couple of times, several times. I saw him down at the Capitol. He works hard. He's dedicated to the cause, and it's great to have people like him around and running this show. It takes a lot of work to do this, and we can't succeed and be successful in what we believe in and getting legislation passed and changing the course of government without people like Tim and other activists. As far as health insurance, I don't take that from the state. I'm fortunate enough, my wife has carried it with her employer. Her employer had a better deal than my employer, so I didn't have to take it from the state. And I don't know, I should know the details, but I didn't take it, so I don't know all the details about the package. But a part of our reform would have included, our pension reform and our state government reform would have included every state employee from the governor on down in a new health care reform for the state employees. We don't exclude ourselves from that, and that's part of the change in politics down there. As far as Tony Bennett, yes, Tony's been down there several times, a lot. I've met with him several times, and it's no lie, it's no secret, Tony and some of the folks in Ramsey County want a stadium really bad out in Arden Hills, and they are, doing what they have a right to do, come down and lobby and talk to legislators and others to try to get their point across and earn support. So yeah, he's been around a while. He knows the game. He knows how to do it. He's smart, and so are the other folks that work with him. But they're dedicated to their cause. They certainly are.
One other thing the caller brought up, isn't the salary $31,000 somewhere around there, mm-hmm. plus per diem?
Yeah, the salary is $31,000 for senators. I believe it's the same for the House,
yes.
House as well. $31,000. Look, I knew what I was getting when I signed up to run for office. I knew what the salary was. I knew the terms. I knew the requirements. And some people, I'll be honest, some people have called me stupid for not taking it. Outright said, that's stupid for not taking it. Well, I didn't take it because I don't need it. I don't need it.
Yeah.
Secondly, it has to do with leadership and examples.
Mm-hmm.
I told people on the campaign trail I wouldn't take it, and they said, well, why? Well, lead by example. It starts with me at the top. Now, I'm not judging other legislators. Everybody's situation is different.
Right.
Especially the outstate folks. They have a long way to travel. They need some help, for lodging and food when they come into town.
Well, and they get that anyway. I mean, that's just mm-hmm. part. That isn't even the per diem. So it used to be $99. A day,
mm-hmm.
then you dropped it down to 78. I
86.
Think 86.
We dropped about 10% when we started.
Yeah, which is a different mindset begin with.
I agree, and that's what we tried to establish. It is a different mindset. We took 10% off the daily per diem. We agreed to it unanimously. I decided not to take it because I don't need it. My employer doesn't pay me extra dollars to eat or drive to work. So I'll stick with it. That's fine with me.
Okay.